Welcome to the latest episode of SWN Podcast. This is episode 5, and I'm joined by the Granite Bruiser, Rayhne. Hello.
We're on podcast now. The man himself.
Yes. One. I like making up nicknames for wrestlers. I'm glad when they actually use them. So it's to be honest, every time I do a preview for yourself, I always just think of Rayhne puns, and when you were coming up to WrestleZone, which I didn't get to see because it never happened, of course, Regal Rumble, I was like so excited because I was like, I've got so many puns in my head, and then didn't get to use any of them one day. Right, so that's as chaotic as an introduction as we could go. So hang on, did you hear that?
I think we're lagging.
Yeah, hang on. I'll stay quiet. What were you saying?
I was saying you couldn't have been that excited to see me because you were going to Inverness to watch SWA instead.
That wasn't my fault. There was two shows that day, and I gave my wife the choice because I was dragging her to a wrestling show either way. And she was like, well, I haven't been to Inverness in a while. I went, that's fine. Afternoon show. We'll go to that. So either way, I was taking her to wrestling, but I gave her the deciding choice. I was gutted though, because that cancelled. And I was like, right, wrestling zone's on. We'll go see that. Bought the tickets. Hours later, show cancelled. So anyway, right. So we'll go for the boring questions, and then I'll pause so we can catch up with the lagging. How did you get into wrestling? What was your first memories?
This is always like such a deep question for loads of people, but like, see, for me, it was like my big brother. Well, when my big brother moved in to stay with us, that was my one thing to do with him, was that I was allowed to stay up till 3 o'clock in the morning and watch wrestling with him. And my first pay per view I watched, couldn't tell you the year because I'm not like a born, but it was the Night of Champions where it was CM Punk versus Jeff Hardy. Because I fell asleep just when Triple H came out, because I couldn't handle it anymore. And then I just started watching like all the stuff on Sky, and then, you know, betting for the Scottish stuff, you saw more stuff on TV, and it just kind of sparked from there.
So that would be 2009, because I am a nerd and have that kind of knowledge. it gets lost. I was 19, so yeah, I feel old, but I never watched it at that time because I couldn't. 2008 was when I stopped watching them live until lockdowns arrived and I can look like this, just with a scrubby t-shirt, and that I work when I'm not going to an office. So but yes, 2009 then, so you got to see kind of like the tail end, like the Jeff Hardy and Edge, because Edge would be 2010. You have done an interview with us before, so I am remembering
bits. It's basically it sort of when like stuff started to go what everyone perceives as the bad era, but I grew up with it, so it's like good to me.
Absolutely, I mean that I've established like with everyone that I've interviewed so far, all four people, is that when you watch it, it's the moments that you grew up with that are the best. Because for me, I grew up in 1999, 2000, so I hit the Attitude Era, so I was quite lucky as a wrestling fan. But like, if you come back to it in 2009, then that's the best bit, because that's the bit that got you into it, isn't it? Mm-hmm. I've got a feeling this is going to be a very, very interesting episode with us trying to catch up with each other. But we'll get through. We'll be fine. So it was 2009. So what brought you to? It was GPWA you started with, wasn't it? So how did you go from being the mad fan to wanting to actually do the actual wrestling?
See, well, most of my friends know the story, right? Because as I describe it, it was the proper X Factor, Britain's Got Talent sob story that will make you vote for me. So, long story kind of short, 2015, on my 19th birthday, my gran passed away and we were up for her funeral, and It was in Aberdeen, and the one person we happened to bump into on the way to my birthday dinner slash the dinner with all the family was wearing an ICW t-shirt, and it was Aspen Faith. And you will have no recollection of this, but my mum talked about all these other wrestlers and how they're so cool. And she was like, "Who's your favourite?" And he was like, "Me." And I'm like, "That guy usually has pleats in his hair, doesn't he?" And yeah. So it's kind of cool, literally being on the streets away from where I stayed, seeing this wrestler that's made it. So I decided at that moment, I was like, "I'm going to go do this." And then we got back home, and then we found out my dad was sick, which was for a few months. He ended up passing away in February, and we're going through his things. Found an old pair of cowboy boots. I couldn't even tell you how it happened, but it ended up that Jack Jester was getting these cowboy boots because they're really expensive, and my mum was like, "We don't need them, we'll just give it to him." So I had to go into Glasgow myself and deliver them to GPWA where he was. And I remember walking in there and just looking at it, and I was like, this is pretty cool. And when I've just spent like months literally just working and kind of being there for someone that's sick, I was like, I've got nothing really to do. And he mentioned that, you know, they've got an induction starting soon, she went to do it. And I was like, didn't even give it a second thought, I just did it. Which I very much regret, because on my first day, we did the warm-up and I couldn't walk for 3 days.
I can honestly say that is the most unique story that I've ever heard from going from fan to wrestler. And as a big fan of Aspen Faith and meeting him a couple times, that is the most Aspen Faith answer to a question that I've ever heard. Me, obviously, because yeah, that sounds about right. So you weren't always with GPWA. You, of course, went to, was it Barhead? Was it Barhead or that you moved to eventually, or was?
Well, actually, how it happened was, so I left there because I had like injury, and then it was basically a point that I couldn't afford to come back because I was like 19 on an 8-hour contract. I couldn't afford it because I was taking like, you know, £30 taxis out of Glasgow because I live in Narnia where trains don't start till like lunchtime. So when I'd started working in a bar in Glasgow, I did try to go to Source, but what was happening was I'd finish at 4 o'clock in the morning, go to my friend's house, wake him up at 5 o'clock in the morning, go back to sleep, and we'd get up at 10 to try and go to Source to try and train there. And then that clearly wasn't working. So I thought, I'm done. You know, give it up. You tried. It's fine. And it was like a year later that I had my friend Stonewall. He was like, just come back. Like, come to my school. Like, we can do this together. And after a few weeks, because I couldn't face going there, like the anxiety got the best of me. But after a few weeks, finally took my first class there, and you know, never looked back since.
Fantastic. So when was your in-ring debut, your official debut?
The 27th or 28th, I couldn't tell you the exact date because I had the ticket on my wall, and no word of a lie, the dog ate it. So it was about 27th, 28th of December 2018.
So is that, would that be now a tax show, was Academy of Tax, or was it a full show?
I got the luxury of having Lou King Sharp as my tag team partner against Angel Hayes and Lucha DS.
Not a bad combo to go in with. I think I remember from your last interview that we did, but it was by email, that Angel Hayes was one that you quite like getting in the ring with anyway, just because her confidence brings your confidence up and it's all works out. So what was it like actually having that match in front of actual people?
Well, I was very worried because especially when it's essentially three actual made stars and then like me who doesn't know anything. So I was kind of worried, and there was a bit of trying to plan it, it was getting stressful. And then I went, I was all nervous, and I went out there, and Lou tried to jump in my arms, and I almost dropped him. Like, well, he might be small, but he's a hench little boy. And then he was like, you're running to me now. And then he just dropped me. And me, normally, I would be like, that's so embarrassing. Oh my God, I can't believe that just happened. I'll hide in a corner. But everyone was laughing, and it just kind of, it switched that gear for me, where it was like, you're a character. It's not personal. So you can do the same back, you know?
And definitely, when you're in with someone like Lou, who is all character, it's not a bad trio to be in with, especially for your first match. So a couple of matches in PBW. What were your in that company? What were your memories of having those matches? Like, well, favorite matches, I should say.
I only had two matches with that company. Obviously the debut that I did work towards, like I worked very hard towards it, and then the next match was kind of a lucky break for me. Like, it wasn't something I was meant to be getting, but the opportunity just kind of happened. But having that made me confident in myself that, you know, I can take things in very quickly and I can do, but it also made me very unconfident because I realised, you know, not that I was terrible, but there was so much more room to grow, and I didn't know where to start first, and that just kind of like brought me down a little bit, but it was still a good learning curve.
So from there, again, correct me if I'm wrong, you went to Dundee, and that's when you got opportunities against Holy Dead.
Yep.
So how what was it like getting... That's quite a big match for someone so new. So what was it like working with Holy Dead?
Yeah. It was absolutely amazing. I can remember sitting in the car and I was having to text people because I was having, like, I'd worked towards this and I put myself out there, but I was sitting having anxiety attacks in the car. And then I got there and I introduced myself and she did the same back. And it changed. The match was meant to be a singles match, but then it turned out they were like, right, we're gonna make it a mixed tag match that's main event, and I'm like, that's even more. But she literally just turned around to me and was like, what do you want to do? And I was like, for me, I've learned, you know, you listen to those that have been there longer than you, like, you know, tell them what you can do or tell them what you can't do, but you know, you leave it to them. And she was just like, no, like, tell me what you want to do, you're new, like, I want to make you look good and stuff. And it was like, this is the total opposite of everything I thought this would be. And then she asked me to take her finisher, and I was like, I don't know if I could do that. And she was like, it's fine, we'll just go out there and do it, which usually I wouldn't recommend, but we did practice it. And honestly, by the time I got out there, I didn't have time to think, and then I was upside down and then in my face in 3 seconds. So it was a really great experience.
So you got quite a lot of big matches there, including at the Caird Hall against Lizzie Styles. So in Dundee, you were the big baddie. Am I right in thinking you're the bad guy? I'm just going by pictures of you mugging crowd members, which is easy to do in Dundee. But but yeah. So, what was it like wrestling at the Caird Hall?
It was do you know, it wasn't even the venue for me. Like, as much as that was a big deal and it was a big open space, it was the fact that at that time I was struggling with like who I was. Like, I felt like the lowest of the low. And it, like, you know, all these other girls are doing things and building themselves up and stuff, and I'm just kind of stuck here at the bottom, but at least I had this. And then Lizzie showed up and she was kind of just as nervous, and but she was fantastic. And like when I went out there, all I could focus on was having the match. Like it didn't matter how big or small a crowd was or anything. It was just the fact, here's somebody that's been on TV and been in the big stuff, and here she is like about to have a match with this, what I perceive myself as this small little person in the world of Scottish wrestling.
So from there, we'll leave Dundee in the rear view. You were in the main event of the first Fair City Wrestling show. For those that are listening to the podcast, Rayhne is modelling a Fair City Wrestling t-shirt, which I'm sure is available on the internet. Find it somewhere. So that was a triple threat. I have no notes here, so this is all off the top of my head, so if I'm wrong, just tell me. Against Sami Zayn and Angel Hayes, who just mentioned. What was it like wrestling in Fair City Wrestling's first main event, or the first show in Perth?
It was terrible, in the best way, but for two reasons. One was the fact that I was going in there with Sami Zayn. I was terrified because I'm like, right, Angel Hayes is great. Sammy's like amazing, and like you have to go do that. And I'm pretty sure there was a lot of critics that would have added to that, like, yeah, I agree, why this one in it? But you know what? I managed to go out and hang with the best of them. And the second reason that it was horrible is the day of the show, I woke up and couldn't walk. Basically, how everybody's saying now that, you know, coronavirus happened back in like October to December, everyone was feeling sick. Yeah, I had that. And basically, right before and after the match, I was having to lie down, be sick, was dizzy, couldn't see anything. And you can tell it in the match because I couldn't put tan on and I couldn't put makeup on. But I still managed to go out there for 25 minutes just to prove all those people that, you know, I didn't want to disappoint the FCW team, and I didn't want to disappoint myself to give in to such people that thought that.
Well, I mean, as probably one of the two people that reviewed the show, and they're both on my website actually, it was of the two people, I loved the match. So whatever you're thinking of your performance, I enjoyed it. And it was your first match that I'd actually seen, well, on Vimeo. Because I haven't actually seen you live in person, and I really enjoyed it. I instantly became a fan, so I would end up just tweeting nonsense about you, just saying, check this girl out, check her out, she's great. Because you don't get, I find in Scottish wrestling anyway, bar maybe Sarah Marie Taylor, you don't get that many powerhouses in Scottish wrestling. They're all high flyers or technicals or anything like that, and so it makes you stand out straight away because you'll just fling people about, which I'm all for. So from there, you pretty much mainstay. I think you've been just about every main event in Fair City. I mean, you've done three shows, but have you been main event for all three? Am I right thinking?
Yeah, main event of two, because I was at another show for the December show.
So that was, I can't remember what the main event was for that, but it'll be somewhere in the archives. So Fair City Wrestling clearly is a company close to your heart, because it's no secret that you're good friends with the promoter, John, who always, as soon as I put a podcast out, will ask, has anyone said anything nice about me? So we're another podcast, another compliment-laden John Young podcast, I'm sure it will be. But how did you get involved with Fair City Wrestling? Was it just through John, or was it just...
Well, it was actually... it was John that helped me break out in Dundee. The whole reason I got an opportunity up there was because I was actually meant to go to a seminar for Casey Spinelli, which unfortunately got cancelled. And then I sent an email to the booker, which was kind of ignored, and then a few months later I decided, right, I'm going to get my CV out there. sent it to their Facebook page this time because I was like, I'm not going to rush the email again. And John was one of the people that had access to the Facebook, so he instantly saw it and messaged me personally and was like, I'm going to push for this, I'm going to push for you. Guy never met me before, never had seen me, nothing, but was just like, you know, you've put yourself out there, like, you deserve to at least have a chance. And it was never talked about seriously, but for the whole time I was in Dundee, he was always talking about wanting to do more shows and wanting to create something to give those that don't get opportunity more opportunities. And it just so happened to come about that he was able to create something to do that. And him and Kev, for some reason, decided to stick me in there with the top tier talent in Scotland. And honestly, I thank them so much, because I wouldn't have had that opportunity if it wasn't for them.
So from your in-ring aspect at Fair City, you've also got a very important role after all that's went down over the last couple of months, which I'm sure anyone listening will be aware of it, and we'll probably touch on it a little bit later on. But let's talk about your new role in Fair City Wrestling for a little bit. What is it? What does it involve? What do you plan?
It's just basically there's more to it, but obviously the kind of basics is just having the female talent officer there for whether it's the girls that want to come to me or even the guys feel more comfortable talking to me for any issues going on backstage or anything, they've got somebody to come to. A lot of people have spoken about how you shouldn't have officers that are kind of like, you know, in the business and or a part of your brand. But anybody that knows me, that even if I really hate somebody, I still think things through from other people's perception. And especially with this whole movement, like, I've understood everything from everyone's point of view. Whether they're right or wrong, I still respect that that's their opinion. And it's for that reason that even though I am part of the roster, like, I'm still there to help in any way I can.
Well, it's definitely, I mean, anyone who's seen your social media at RayhnePW, they can clearly see that you're very outspoken when it comes to injustice, like some sort of superhero. There is a lot of people saying you can't have wrestlers in that kind of positions, which you're right in saying and responding to. I think the main thing at this stage is we've got to have the shows start first before we can see if it works. I mean, there is some places that are just doing it totally wrong, which we won't mention, but there is this movement of putting people in charge of wrestlers. Got to try it before we can cast judgment on it being right or wrong. Just got to try it. So let's move away from wrestling just for a second, because there's something that you enjoy watching that I have never watched. And from last week's show, finding out about memes with Ian Skinner, which was an enlightening experience, and I'm still recovering from Avatar.
I have never watched it.
What is it about Avatar that people need to know about it? People need to watch it.
It's just so good. Like, do you know, I actually wish, like, she's just next to me, whichever way's empty. I wish I had Grant McIver here with me, and we could honestly be cheerleaders for that show for hours. Like, it's like, even though it's a kid show, there's, you know how like kid shows usually have, like, you know, they slip in the little like dirty remarks and the little dirty jokes and stuff. It's like there's a couple in there, but there's more the kind of, you know, good human values and respect and that, everything that comes with that show. And it's just like, even though it's a cartoon, just watching Uncle Iroh just makes me want to be a better person. That's that's all I can say. Like, that's Uncle Iroh is just the whole shape of it.
So am I right in thinking not just Avatar, you're a big anime fan? Is that right? Again, not something I've ever watched or read. So give me some recommendations if there's any that you can watch.
I actually wasn't, I'd watched the kind of, and it's so bad that I've forgotten the brand name. Oh my God, I'm going to get slated by anyone that watches this and knows. There's like, I actually can't remember the studio, and I'm sorry because it's gone. But the people that made like Spirited Away and like those movies I'd always grown up with. But as I grew up, I kind of like just kind of strayed from that. And it was actually my boyfriend more recently, we've just started to watch things because obviously with lockdown, we didn't really have much to do. So we just watched things over Discord. And actually right now, when this call ends, I actually have My Hero Academia on my screen to resume to sit and watch. But that's like wrestling, you know, there's so many genres to it, there's so many different things. Like the one I'm watching just now is an action-packed superhero against all the big bad guys. The one I was watching earlier today, Haikyuu, was a story about boys playing volleyball. Still made me cry, but it's boys playing volleyball, but somehow it's really that good. And just the effort of it, the animation, the drawings, like everything, I appreciate all the work of it, just like I would with wrestling. So it's kind of two come hand in hand.
Okay, so we'll swing back to wrestling for a second then. Where did you come up with the name Rayhne? What was the inspiration behind it?
I hate to give her a bigger head than she's already got. And I'm sorry for saying that, Mum. but it was actually my mum that came up with the name Rayhne. Because while we were at GPWA, it was Jester that kind of said, you know, don't think about it too much, but like start thinking on your characters. Just kind of like, you're still new, so you don't need to go buy your whole costume and everything, but you know, start kind of evolving yourself. And obviously doing this straight after with my dad passing, like the one thing we could both think about was Prince. But she hates the way I spell it though. She absolutely hates it. She's like, it's so stupid. And I'm like, but it reminds me of my name because you know, people always say my name's not spelled correctly, so it was just kind of something new to do.
Oh, the first couple of times I had to put like matches up and results, the amount of times I spelled your name wrong was just unbelievable. But I think I've got there now, and hopefully when whoever's watching this and look up and will actually see that I've spelled it correctly. If not, I'm going to have the Granite Bruiser come in to kick my behind, whenever that may be. Hopefully, when WrestleZone shows resume, because I really wanted to see you. Even though I was going to Inverness that day, I still wanted to see the Rigo Rumble.
It would have actually been my first time. Well, it's a bit longer than that now, but back then it would have actually been my first time in Aberdeen in 4 years. That's how long it's been since I've been up there.
So you've got like a bucket list. I mean, we're still in lockdown. Nothing's happening. So what's your bucket list of companies or opponents, or what do you want to do in the immediate future, first year back?
Well, I'm not going to lie. There's still that, it's went from 80% to like 5%, but for like the past 2 weeks, there's been that solid, I don't want to come back. Not just because people getting to me, it's just that's kind of perception where I'm still kind of lowest of the low, and I don't feel like I'm physically good enough just because I've got my own personal issues with my body. So it's kind of like, yes, I love it, but is it time to just kind of give it up? And then the more people just telling me, no, you're not allowed, I was like, right, okay. So originally my plan was like, debut in the first year, do some things in the second year, and then debut for WrestleZone in the third year. That was kind of my high hopes. And then I had it so close, and it didn't happen. So now the plan is to hopefully work basically anywhere. People will be like, aim for the big leagues, but one of my favourite shows was KFNS, which I had, I'd say, about a 9-minute match in, but that whole family crowd, and it was just great compared to going out there with a bunch of, like, I don't want to say marks, because that's, I don't like that word, but a bunch of people just waiting for you to mess up, essentially. So the hope is, I haven't asked these people yet, but I'm hoping to get guidance off of a few people to train myself even harder to prove that to myself it's worth staying about. And then basically, if I get an opportunity as a result, then that's fine. But if I don't, that's also fine. Just come with me afterwards.
So we were speaking about KFNS, that's Combat League Wrestling, for anyone interested. From what I've seen when they were KFNS, it's much like WrestleZone, where the fans in attendance are here to see wrestling. They're here to see characters, they're here to see some fun and frolics. And bar maybe the bigger shows, the ones at Northern Hotel or Arbor Anarchy, it's very much a family event. They'll go to see the wrestling. They're all queuing up at 12 o'clock in the afternoon for a show that's happening at 5, which is true, because when I'm coming through, I have to go past around the hotel because we go to the beach or something like that, and there's folk, always the same folk, queuing up waiting to get their picture with like Crusher Crabe or that, and I would love to have that much commitment, but I simply don't want to stand any longer than I have to in a queue. So for those that are watching the video stream, they'll notice that myself and Rayhne have changed. That was because the recording equipment died all of a sudden. So we lost about 10, 15 minutes of amazing content. You should have heard what was there. It was just incredible. Unfortunately, it'll never see the light of day. So welcome back, Rayhne. Welcome back to the show. Even though it's been 1 second for everyone else, it's been a whole day for us. We were speaking about your bucket list. So we spoke about KFNS and WrestleZone. And before everything went haywire, you were speaking about Northern Hotel and how special it was to you. So we're kind of going to go back to where we were and then speak for another 10, 15 minutes and wrap up so you can have an evening, and so can I. So, bit about Northern Hotel. So, what would it mean to you to wrestle at the Northern Hotel in Aberdeen?
Well, it's actually it was the venue where I was at on my birthday for my grandmother's wake, and it's actually only 10 minutes down the road from where my granddad and my auntie actually stay, and where we used to stay. So it's one of those that, even though Aberdeen's not really my home, that venue and that area is my home, and it would mean a lot just to even come out. Like, let me valet Caleb, right? We'll get Alan out the way. I'll come out and valet Caleb, and that'd be good enough for me.
I think you mean you want to valet Blue Thunder.
Anybody at this point, no.
I'd be all in. It's no secret I'm a humongous fan of Caleb, so yeah, seeing that as a combo, I'm paying. If there's a show going on in Inverness the same day, I'm ignoring it. I'm coming to that one if I'm getting to see that tandem. So before we were rudely interrupted by technology, we moved on to your influences, one of them being Nikki Cross. So What is it? Why is Nikki Cross one of your influences?
Well, like, as the kind of big girl, like, I'm not, I wouldn't say I'm fat or huge, shush dog, I'll give you attention later. I wouldn't say I'm big. I wouldn't say I'm that tall either, except any time I've stepped in the ring with another girl, it's kind of like, hi, nice to meet you. Because I'm only like 5'9", but before that, it was just kind of having to have the powerhouse sort of style, even though I didn't really have the muscle or the strength for it. So upon watching different people, of course I would watch things like China would do and stuff like that and be like, that's really cool, like kind of a cool military press in the middle of it, you know, like I can't do that right now, maybe one day, but not right now. Whereas you watch Nikki and it's just all personality. She comes out and she could be all mouth or all smile, and she could hit two moves, but you're damn sure that those two moves are going to look like the most devastating things on this planet. So it's because of her I started to kind of look at what I was doing, incorporate some of her moves into my moveset, and just I took a lot of inspiration from her for sure.
It's one of those things, like her partner in WWE right now is Alexa Bliss. She was interviewed recently and she was saying that she doesn't have to do all these moves, she just has to make the moments. So yeah. that's pretty much the kind of thing Nikki Storm was about.
There's a match from Dundee and it's a six man. I couldn't tell you entirely who's in the match, but I remember, I think it's like Scott Renwick, Nikki and somebody else against Grado, someone and Sammy. And obviously Grado, he's going to get the cheers and all that regardless, but I watched that whole match, took it in, and personally I thought if it wasn't for Nikki going around the fans, giving them abuse and just being herself, it wouldn't have been as good as it was.
I think I can't remember. I'm trying to remember because I think I may have seen that. It was at the Bonner Hall.
Yes, it was.
I did see it. I can't remember who was in it myself, but I do remember that. And Nikki just has that way of just going around ringside and just drawing everyone in to it's like takes all the applause to herself and then puts it straight to the ring, which is just a skill. It's definitely a skill that obviously the pros can do. And one of those things. So who else would be, male or female, would be like top of your influences?
It's actually very hard. Like, I've got like all this wrestling stuff on my wall, and it's not even because he's part of the school, it's not even because he's helped me out so much, but actually one of my biggest influences from the Scottish scene would be Stevie Boy and Kreiger, even though both completely different styles, both completely different people. With Stevie, he helped me a lot trying to find myself, and when he came back, it was an unfortunate incident all round. But when he came back to wrestling, like, I'll never forget that moment of just everybody cheering. Because he's a great talent. Like, I would put him up there as, like, number one talent in Scotland. And Kreiger, we've seen him, like, essentially start from the bottom. And, you know, almost right at the very top. Like, I don't know what would make it hit the very top, but he's worked on himself, worked on his fitness, tried everything he could, see what worked, see what didn't work, and he'd always have time for everyone, even though he himself was working on his own things. So it's very encouraging to see that, you know, it's not just all doom and gloom and people actually care, even though they've got themselves to care about too.
I can definitely attest to Kreiger. I love watching Stevie Boy as well. He's just incredible. But Kreiger, I think I first saw him round about his beginnings when Inverness came up for Rock and Wrestle. When he had the luminous pink tights and the and yep. the headband and all that kind of stuff, and to see him go from that to he's just a humongous ball of charisma. Ball's yep. probably not the right word. That makes him sound humongous, like fat. But
that because you'll feel bad. No, you're
he is ripped and jacked, and I'm just looking sharp. But yeah, he's just he's a guy that I can honestly see he could be a top champion in any company if people put the faith in him that he could be that guy. When we had our break for the last day, I had the thought of more matches I'd actually seen you in, because it's not just Fair State Wrestling. There's one that came to mind that kind of attests to that do one or two moves, one two moments, and that was your match against Lisa Lace. That I really enjoyed. So, of course, she's an international talent. She was on NXT, I think, NXT, not long beforehand. So what was it like coming up against someone who's been in, even briefly, been in that WWE system?
Well, this is when it gets personal, okay? But we won't give too much away. But at that time, unfortunately, I was going through a breakup. And it was actually the anniversary of my dad passing as well. So it was, obviously, I wasn't meant to be on the card. And then I was put on the poster and I was like, okay. And then, like, before the show, they were like, oh, so we've got this is happening, you've got a match, and you're going to be in the big rumble as well. And I'm like, right, okay, cool, I can do that. And then, as soon as I got there, it was just like, I have to see my ex now around all of his friends. Yes. But I didn't even have time to get ready. By the time me and Lisa started talking, and we spent more time talking about other things than we did like talking about the match. There's still some things that I wasn't happy with, but it's not like anything was bad, it's just could have been improved upon, which, you know, is the best you could ask for. And the fact that I could go out there and I had full confidence in her and she had full confidence in me, even though compared to each other, like, I'm an absolute nobody and she's an American star, was a really good feeling. A definite great feeling. And if she ever comes back, I know John's hungry to use her again, so I'm not opposed to that at all.
That's it. Next time you'll be fighting over the FCW Women's Championship, I'm sure. But who knows? I don't want to spoil anything because I don't know anything to spoil. So right now, we'll kind of wind our way down, because I don't want to. We already did half an hour of really great chat. 10-15 minutes of incredible chat that nobody will ever hear, and then we'll just finish off here. At the moment, we've got a poster on sale, and I think we should speak a little bit about the speaking out movement. Not too much, because if anyone goes on your social media, they'll see quite a lot in what's said. We don't want to muddy into that. So I just want to talk about the poster and what the idea behind it was, and just what it's for.
Well, initially I'd actually seen a company called Wrestle Island down in England do something kind of similar. It was just with their girls on the roster, and they were kind of teasing that they were going to put it on sale. Now I've spoken to a lot of women since this has started to happen from Scotland and England, and for a lot of it I have said that it kind of feels hard in Scotland, that as people are kind of supporting it, but there's nobody really there to, I don't know, not an ambassador, but just kind of there so you know you're protected. Like, I feel like Debbie Keitel's doing a really great job for Ireland, and then you've got all the girls down in England doing amazing things. And then here it was just kind of, if you said anything, someone was going to get angry. And I honestly just wanted to do something good instead of, you know, plugging our own merchandise or anything. I wanted to make something good, and that's why hopefully we'll also have a video coming on the way as well, to just kind of be like, this, yes, right now this is a bad thing, but unfortunately this is a bad thing that we've dealt with for years that you guys are only seeing now. But that doesn't mean it's over. Like, wrestling's not going to disappear because of this. Like, we're still going to come back, and I was really grateful for Adam for essentially putting the whole creative effort into the poster, and also all the women that happily said they were okay with using their images on the poster. Because if you said to me as a little fan 4 years ago that, you know, you're just going to have this idea to make a poster for charity and Kaylee Ray is going to say she's okay with being on it, I'd be like, no, what are you talking about? That's Kaylee Ray. But it's just something positive for the fans, essentially. That's hence with every package that I've actually sent out, I've put in a handwritten note to each of them, just because, like, those people, they all deserve it. Like, be nothing without the fans.
I've been a very, very happy recipient of when you do your merch. Do you always put a handwritten note in, or because when I won an 8x10, I was ecstatic for one. But secondly, the note that I got in with it was actually like moved me to tears, which I don't do that. Well, actually, I think the older I've gotten, the more emotional I've become. I don't know why that's happened, but just the personal touch to it was just incredible. And the fact that you're doing this poster as well, just goes to show how much you care about this
oh, yeah.
world, this scene.
It was just unfortunate because I had Gemini, or Gia Adams as she's now known, involved with something within the Scottish scene as well. So it was kind of like, I felt horrible because I also, it's something I had to go for myself as well, and it was kind of like, it's how it all started for me. Even though it's stupid and ridiculous, I felt responsible because I was like, if I hadn't stopped this then, it wouldn't have spread literally to another country and happened there. And that's when I was just like, you know, I'm going to be hated and I'm going to get all this stuff, but enough is enough. Like, this is restart everything from here right now.
I don't think you can blame, you definitely can't blame yourself, because I mean, the stuff that's coming out is actually gone a bit serious. Let's lighten up after this. You can't blame yourself because this has been going on since before you'd even debuted, before you'd even started. And there's been stories and rumors. It's just taken one or two people to actually go public for it to start coming out. So
For every person that's kind of being negative and telling me that I shouldn't say something about someone, I actually have about, you know, 5 people in my messages being like, thank you, or be like, I experienced this too. And the fact that I even had bigger stars within wrestling kind of messaging me and having my back and just being like, I'm sorry, I didn't do anything to help. And I'm like, you're like an idol of mine. Don't be sorry. It's these people's fault, not your fault. But we can't help ourselves. Everyone that's apologising are the people that don't need to apologise at the end of the day.
Exactly. I mean, I know I've had some experience, but I'll leave that to the wayside. So which charities are benefiting from this poster? Which is £5, by the way, which is a ridiculous bargain.
Yeah, it's even up on my wall right now. And it's kind of bad because the charities are right there on my phone, but kind of used for a video call right now, so I actually don't know. I know one's the South Lanark. Because the South Lanark means a lot to me, so...
I would go and check, but as if I try to minimise, it goes, we'll stop recording, and I don't want that to happen. So what I'll do is, if you're watching this on... We'll do part three tomorrow. So what I'll do is I'll put the charities in the description below on the YouTube and everything, and I'll put them on the podcast as well, and then share them everywhere. So it's fine. We'll at least... And I'll put links up, so it'll be all good. Like I said, I don't want to keep you too long for this kind of wrap up bit at the end. So let's just wrap it up then. So your social media, where can people find you?
Well, it's very hard. So you've got Instagram, which is RaynePW. You've got Twitter, that is again RaynePW. Facebook, which is also the same, and also TikTok. You know, you'll have half the people are like, oh, TikTok, but you'll have the losers like me that's like, it's actually pretty fun. So come join, come be one of the losers with us.
I don't understand TikTok, but it's fine. I'm not going to judge anyone. But so yeah, everywhere. So yeah, thank you for taking time. Thank you for this bit as well. I could have just ended it at 30 minutes cutting off. Is there anything else you want to plug while we're here and before I let you go?
Do you know, I don't want to plug anything, but for as much as this has been about me, I'd like to thank you yourself for considering me for this and also even putting the effort all over lockdown and before lockdown. For all the effort you do for Scottish wrestling and Adam and the whole team as well, because honestly, if it wasn't for you guys, my love would have dried up a long time ago, and you don't hear that enough, but you guys are great.
Well, thank you. And you wouldn't have met Colton Davis either.
Exactly. Please, somebody book that tag team match. Please, like, anywhere. I don't care if it's in a field. I need to tag with Colton.
Get Colton Davis and Chris Clark as manager. We've got it sorted. That'll be the first thing that happens out of lockdown. But perfect. Thanks you again, and thank you for your kind words. To be honest, I've just been trying anything to keep myself occupied during all this, and it started with the tournaments, and then it's gone to Twitch, and now which 2K20 is just the worst game ever, so that stopped, and now I'm doing podcasts, and you're actually one of the first names on my list. But when all this came out, I thought I will give her a couple of weeks. We'll let things calm down a little bit, so it's not like a total, like, serious fest like it got towards the end there. But yeah, absolutely. Thank you for taking part, and again, thank you for agreeing to do the second part, and maybe we'll do an actual part 2 sometime in the future, once the show's begin again.
Maybe.